The urban extension of the Western is undoubtedly the gangster genre. Much like the Westerns, we are fascinated by the men who dwell in the underworld of the big cities. From Cesar Bandello to Cody Jarrett, from Michael Corleone to Frank Sheeran. The gangster genre has provided us with some of the most compelling stories, and today I'm going to list 12 of my favorite of those films. This is my top 12 favorite gangster pictures.
Been spending most of their lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of our lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of our lives living in the gangster's paradise.
Number 12. Pulp Fiction. Released in 1994, Pulp Fiction follows three interrelated stories involving two gangsters, played by John Travolta and Samuel L. Jackson, their boss's sexy wife, played by Uma Thurman, and a prize fighter, played by Bruce Willis. Pulp Fiction was the second feature film from the mind of filmmaker Quentin Tarantino.
And you came pulling in here. Did you notice the sign out in the front of my house that said Dead Nigger Storage?
Jimmy, you know I ain't seen no shit.
Did you notice the sign in the front of my house that said Dead Nigger Storage?
No, I didn't.
You know why you didn't see that sign?
Why?
Because it ain't there, because storing dead niggers ain't my fucking business, that's why.
What Tarantino does is he manages to take these three central characters and play it out in episodic stories. Pulp Fiction also is known for some pretty quotable dialogue.
You know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
They don't call it a quarter pounder with cheese?
Oh, man, they got the metric system. They wouldn't know what the fuck a quarter pounder is.
And what do they call it?
They call it Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese.
That's right.
What do they call a Big Mac?
Big Mac's a Big Mac, but they call it Le Big Mac.
Le Big Mac.
And like Martin Scorsese's films, balances horrific violence with moments of comedy.
Marvin, what do you make of all this?
Man, I don't even have an opinion.
Well, you gotta have an opinion. I mean, do you think that God came down from heaven and stopped?
Oh, what the fuck's happening in the house, man?
Oh man, I shot Marvin in the face.
Why the fuck did you do that?
Well, I didn't mean to do it. It was an accident.
With a cast that also includes Ving Rhames, Harvey Keitel, Christopher Walken, and Tim Roth, Pulp Fiction received the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival and was even awarded with an Oscar for its screenplay.
And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
Number 11. Scarface. Released in 1983 and directed by Brian De Palma with a screenplay by Oliver Stone, Scarface stars Al Pacino as Tony Montana, a Cuban refugee who rises up and becomes a powerful drug lord.
This country, you gotta make the money first. Then when you get the money, you get the power. Then when you get the power, then you get the woman.
The idea of Scarface came about when Al Pacino saw the 1932 film starring Paul Muni. More about that film later. Pacino then presented the idea to producer Marty Bergman, who initially hired Sidney Lumet to direct, but creative differences caused him to drop out, and Bergman then decided on Brian De Palma.
Do you want to play rough? Okay. Say hello to my little friend!
Oliver Stone was also battling a cocaine habit of his own while writing the script. The film is also remembered for being extremely violent and a copious amount of profanity.
Fuck Gaspar Gomez and fuck the fucking Dio!
Fuck you!
I don't give a fuck!
Can't you stop saying fuck all the time?
Hey, fuck you, mate!
The film also ran into problems with the MPAA, who gave the film an X rating numerous times. When it opened, it received overwhelmingly negative reviews and only a moderate success financially. Now, thanks to the advent of video and airings on TV, it has been regarded as a cult classic. People in the rap and hip-hop industry hold this film to high regard.
Me, I want what's coming to me.
Oh, well, what's coming to you?
The world, Chico. And everything in it.
Number 10. Gangster Squad, based on the book by Paul Lieberman. Gangster Squad is a fictional account of the LAPD officers and detectives who work together to bring down Jewish mob boss Mickey Cohen.
You heard of Manifest Destiny? That's when you take what you can when you can't. The Greases took it from the Redskins and we took it from them. And I'm gonna take it all from you, Jack, and not just because I can. Because this is my destiny. Los Angeles is my fucking destiny, you motherfucker.
I know not a lot of people, especially critics, like this film, but for some reason, I enjoy films like this. I enjoy films set during that time period. It almost feels like a comic book film in its presentation. It's not the most historically accurate, as Mickey Cohen it was a real gangster, and a lot of the events depicted in this film probably didn't really happen, but much like Zack Snyder's 300 or even Disney's Davy Crockett, it's the kind of story I want to believe happened. It features brilliant performances from Josh Brolin,
come and get it, Cohen,
and Sean Penn.
Here comes Santa Claus!
Also included are Emma Stone and Ryan Gosling in their second of three films they made together.
What's your racket, handsome?
Mostly I just like to play games.
I bet. What kind of games?
I like to play post office.
Post office? It's a kid's game.
Not the way I play it.
And quite a few shootouts that are pretty well done. Speaking of which, there was a scene that took place at Grauman's Chinese Theater where a shootout breaks out, but following the aftermath of the Aurora shooting during a screening of The Dark Knight Rises, the scene was removed and reshot and took place in Chinatown. The added scene is very well done, with lots of suspense and tension. Also, it makes more sense since mobsters were known to hang out in Chinatown during that time period. Also, the look of the film reminds me of the detective video game L.A. Noir. If they ever did L.A. Noir as a film, this is probably what it would look like.
You can't shoot me. You're a cop.
Not anymore.
Number 9. Little Caesar. Based on the W.R. Burnett book, it tells the story of the rise and fall of Caesar Enrico Bandello.
If you ain't out of town by tomorrow morning, you won't never leave it except in a pine box. I'm taking over this territory. From now on, it's mine.
This film has been regarded as the gangster film that really jump-started the gangster genre. Although there had been other gangster films before this, but this has been regarded by historians and filmmakers as the first great gangster film.
Sam, you can dish it out, but you're getting so you can't take it no more.
This was the film that made a star out of Edward G. Robinson. Not an Italian, but was casted mainly because he bore a striking resemblance to Al Capone.
You go back to that dame, and a suicide. Suicide for both of you.
Directed by Mervyn LeRoy, Little Caesar set the stage for future gangster films to follow.
Mother of mercy. Is this the end of Rico?
Number 8. White Heat. Based on the story by Virginia Kellogg, White Heat is the story of Cody Jarrett, a psychotic gangster with a major mother complex.
Always thinking about your Cody, aren't you?
After winning his Oscar for Yankee Doodle Dandy, James Cagney left Warner Brothers to make films under his own production company with his brother William. After four flops, Cagney returned to Warner Brothers. He selected White Heat as his comeback film. However, one thing he suggested before agreeing to do it was to really make this guy into a psychopath.
How you doing, Parker?
Oh,
stuffy, huh? I'll give it a layer.
One of the most memorable scenes in the film is when in jail, Jarrett hears the news that his mother died. Cagney said that the inspiration of his reaction came from a visit to a mental institution when he was a youngster. 600 extras were involved in this scene, and none of them knew what Cagney was going to do. So the reactions you see are genuine. It's probably Cagney's most explosive performance. Number 7. The Public Enemy. Based on the book Beer and Blood by John Bright and Kubrick Glassman, tells the story of Tom Powers, a violent gangster and a killer at the height of Prohibition.
Hey, Garrett. Somebody's got to protect your customers.
But what am I going to do? I can't help it if I have to buy from Schemer Burns. They tell me the same thing that you do.
You're yellow.
Please, you ain't gonna slug me, are you?
Maybe not today. But I'm telling you this for the last time. When Dutch comes around, he's gonna leave you some beer. And you're gonna take it. And you're gonna kick him with a dough. If you don't, somebody's gonna drop by here and kick your teeth out one at a time. Get me?
Originally, Edward Woods was to play the Tom Powers part, and Cagney was to be the secondary lead. But director William Wellman, a former World War I fighter pilot, decided that Cagney would be more effective as Powers, that he switched roles. That's probably the reason why the youngsters playing their younger counterparts look different. So the younger version of what was going to be Cagney is referred to as Matt, and the younger version of what was going to be Woods is referred to as Tom. Maybe because their scenes were shot first, and they didn't have time to go back and reshoot the kids' scenes again, but what are you going to do? Nevertheless, the film made James Cagney into a star.
I wish you was a wishing well, but I'd like to tie a bucket to you and sink you.
Maybe you found someone you like better.
The result was Cagney would be ultimately typecast as a tough guy, when in reality he was more a song and dance man.
No good yellow-bellied stool. I'm gonna give it that putty nose right in the head the first time I see him.
Yeah, you and who else?
It was Wellman's intention to make The Public Enemy the toughest, violent gangster film ever made. But the next spot on my countdown would ultimately outdo this film immensely.
I ain't so tough.
Ugh. Number 6. Scarface. Based on the novel by Armitage Trail, tells the story of Tony Camonte, a gangster who rises up the ranks in the Chicago criminal underworld.
Look at that monkey there!
They think they're gonna get Johnny Camani, eh?
It was business tycoon Howard Hughes who wanted to do this film inspired by the life of Al Capone, and to outdo the other previous gangster films, Little Caesar and The Public Enemy. To direct the film, Hughes chose Howard Hawks, at the time was undergoing a lawsuit against Hughes. To write the screenplay, they chose Ben Hecht, considered to be the greatest screenwriter that ever lived. To play Camonte, Paul Muni was casted after initially turning it down, feeling he wasn't physically suited for the role.
I'm giving you orders for the last time.
There's only one thing that gets orders and gives orders, and this is it. That's how I got the south side for you, and that's how I'm going to get a north side for you. Some little typewriter, right? I'm going to write my name all over this town with it in big letters.
Hey, stop him, somebody.
Get out of my way, Johnny. I'm going to spit.
Hawks and Hughes managed to really outdo the other previous gangster films and made it the most visually exciting and violent gangster film ever made. Of course, it ran into censorship problems, both state and international. It was banned in Chicago, even though the film was about Chicago gangsters. In order to appease the censors, some scenes that showed people overtly condemning gangsterisms were shot.
Put teeth in the Deportation Act. These gangsters don't belong in this country. Half of them aren't even citizens.
That's true. They bring nothing but disgrace to my people.
Here's a bit of trivia for you. Whenever a character is gonna die, there's an X somewhere in the frame. One of the most clever uses of this motif is in the bowling alley, where Camonte's men rub out Boris Karloff.
Just watch this one.
Martin Scorsese would use this motif in his Oscar-winning crime thriller, The Departed. Number 5. Mean Streets. Released in 1973, Mean Streets is the story of a small-town hoodlum, played by Harvey Keitel, trying to keep the peace between his boyhood friend Johnny Boy, played by Robert De Niro, and the people who he owes money.
Come on. Come on. Come on. Fuck face! I got something for you, motherfucker. Come on. Come on. Come on, motherfucker. My big shot.
It was actor-director John Cassavetes who convinced Martin Scorsese to direct this film. He had seen Scorsese's first Hollywood film, Boxcar Bertha, which he had made for Roger Corman. Cassavetes told Scorsese not to do films like Boxcar Bertha and to do a film similar to his first feature film, Who's That Knocking at My Door? Mean Streets was not only Scorsese's first in what would become a trilogy of films about the mafia, though technically four movies I'll explain later, but also the first film to team both Scorsese and Robert De Niro.
What do you come out going shopping when you owe somebody money, Johnny? That ain't right. How much you got,
Johnny? I'm gonna pay him next week. I'm gonna pay you.
Although the film takes place in New York, a lot of the film was shot in Los Angeles.
This guy's a fucking mook.
I'm a mook.
A mook? What's a mook?
I don't know.
What's a mook?
You can't call me a mook.
I can't?
No.
Made for only $500,000, the film went on to gross $3 million. Number 4. The Irishman, aka I Heard You Paint Houses. Based on the Charles Brandt novel, The Irishman is the true story of Frank the Irishman Sheeran, a truck driver who becomes a hitman involved with the Buffalino crime family, including his time with the president of the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, James R. Hoffa.
I heard you paint houses.
Yes, sir, I do. And I
I also do my own carpentry.
Not only did the Irishman reunite Martin Scorsese with his former collaborators, Robert De Niro and Joe Pesci, who came out of retirement after initially refusing numerous times.
Guess who changed this? Who changed? They fucking...
But this also marks the first time Scorsese got to work alongside legendary actor Al Pacino.
If you got it, a truck brought it to you. The day our trucks stop, America stops!
This was Scorsese's longest and most expensive movie of his career. Most of the film's budget went into developing the state-of-the-art de-aging technology that makes the characters played by De Niro, Pacino, and Pesci look younger than they currently are. What most people don't understand is that they aren't necessarily supposed to look like younger versions of themselves, but younger versions of their characters. So it's obvious that they aren't going to look exactly like the way De Niro and Pacino looked in the 1970s. The Irishman was Scorsese closing the book on the gangster genre, a genre he had long been associated with and is widely remembered for. So in a sense, The Irishman is the epilogue to his three great gangster films. The other two are the next spots on my countdown.
It's gonna happen. Either way, he's going.
Number 3. Goodfellas. Based on the book Wise Guy by Nicholas Pileggi, tells the story of Mafia foot soldier Henry Hill, played by Ray Liotta, and his three decades of life in the Mafia.
As far back as I could remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Goodfellas is the second entry in Scorsese's gangster trilogy, which began with Mean Streets. This time, unlike most gangster films which focus on the boss of the family, Goodfellas takes a soldier in the family and focuses it on his rise and fall. The film also includes Robert De Niro as Jimmy the Gent Conway, based on gangster James Burke.
Never rat on your friends, and always keep your mouth shut.
Joe Pesci in his Academy Award-winning performance as Tommy DeVito, based on gangster Tommy Two Guns DeSimone.
You know, Sonny, you're a real fucking mutt. You know the money we spend in this
about?
Fucking...
Come on, don't be like that.
What do you mean, don't be like that?
Paul Sorvino as Paulie Cicero, based on gang boss Paul Vario.
You think you're the only one? I talked to them a million times. They don't listen.
Lorraine Bracco as Henry Hill's Jewish wife, Karen.
You got some nerve standing, Mia. Nobody does that to me. Who the hell do you think you are? Frankie Valli or some kind of big shot?
And Frank Vincent as William Benvenna, better known as Billy Batts.
Now go home and get your fucking shine box.
Motherfucking mutt! You fucking piece of shit!
One of the best scenes is this moment between Joe Pesci and Ray Liotta.
But I'm funny how? I mean funny like I'm a clown, I amuse you. I make you laugh. I'm here to fucking amuse you. What do you mean funny? Funny how? How am I funny?
Get the fuck out of here, Tommy.
You motherfucker. I almost had him. I almost had him.
And of course, the one shot every film school always brings up is this one long Steadicam shot through the Copacabana. The thing I love about Goodfellas is that the first half leading up to the murder of Billy Batts shows us the attractiveness of being in the world of organized crime. From the Billy Batts murder onward, shows us the consequences of being associated with organized crime. It's a well-made gangster film and one of the best films ever made. Number 2. Casino. Yet another film directed by Martin Scorsese and based on a book by Nicholas Pileggi. This time, it's the story of Sam Ace Rothstein, a sports handicapper and a mafia associate sent by the Midwestern mob to Las Vegas to oversee the Tangiers Casino.
Listen to me very carefully. There are three ways of doing things around here. The right way, the wrong way, and the way that I do it.
Also included in the film are Sharon Stone in her Golden Globe-winning and Oscar-nominated performance as Ace's beautiful turned unhinged wife, Ginger.
I'm going to the FBI! I will go to the police! I have not been touching you anymore, you fuck!
Joe Pesci as Nicky Santoro, based on real-life gangster Tony the Ant Spilotro.
You make me pop your fucking eye out of your head to protect that piece of shit!
Don Rickles, Alan King, James Woods, and Kevin Pollak. Now, some people are wondering why I didn't put Goodfellas on the number two spot. Well, I actually enjoy Casino more than Goodfellas because Casino is basically Goodfellas on a much bigger scale. In fact, look at the three films in Scorsese's gangster trilogy. Mean Streets are lower-class hoodlums committing smaller-scale crimes. Goodfellas are more middle-class gangsters. Casino is upper-class gangsters. The trilogy's epilogue, The Irishman, is gangsters as old men looking back on the life they lived. Each film showing us a different life of crime and the people who lived it. Casino is also the most violent of Scorsese's films, and even reaches its peak with the brutal beating of Joe Pesci and his brother in a cornfield. Scorsese has said that after that, his display of physical violence has never been topped since, and he was no longer interested in depicting physical violence the way he did in his previous films. And my number one favorite gangster picture is... Whenever I think of the perfect gangster picture, I immediately think of The Godfather. The Godfather started out as a popular book by Mario Puzo, and was immortalized as three films directed and co-written by Francis Ford Coppola. The Godfather is the story of the rise and fall of the Corleone crime family, first run by Vito Corleone, and ultimately bequeathed to his reluctant son, Michael.
This wasn't enough time, Michael. Wasn't enough time.
We'll get there, Pop. We'll get there.
The central story of The Godfather is covered in the first two movies, The Godfather and The Godfather Part II, both films winning the Academy Award for Best Picture, the first time a film and its sequel to do so. The third film, now recut and rechristened as The Godfather Coda, The Death of Michael Corleone, serves not as a sequel to The Godfather and The Godfather Part II, but instead as an epilogue to a two-part story, the way Puzo and Coppola intended.
It seems in today's world, the power to absolve debt is greater than the power of forgiveness.
Don't overestimate the power of forgiveness.
The first two Godfathers are the superior films, mainly because it manages to show them as businessmen who would stop at nothing to protect their family, even if it means to kill someone to do it. It also has a lot of quotable lines.
I'm gonna make him an offer he can't refuse.
Leave the gun. Take the cannoli.
Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
Just when I thought I was out, they pull me back in.
Plus, without this, there would probably be no Goodfellas, The Sopranos, or Boardwalk Empire. The character of Vito Corleone became the first character to win not one, but two Academy Awards. First to Marlon Brando for the first Godfather, even though he refused it. The second to Robert De Niro for the second Godfather. It would never happen again until both Heath Ledger and Joaquin Phoenix would both win the Oscar for playing the Joker. Every gangster film has been influenced by these films, and no wonder. They are beautiful stories about family, loyalty, power, violence, and above all, America. The Godfather Saga, my number one favorite gangster picture.